بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention in our hearts to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have come to a very important statement made by Imam Abu Ja'far At-Tahawi in his creed known as Al-Aqeeda At-Tahawiyyah. He said the following statement: one is not at all a Muslim if one does not submit to Allah. So whoever fails to do that and seeks the knowledge of what has been debarred from him and does not assent to attribute that knowledge to the one who knows it, prevents himself by what he sought from sheer tawheed, pure knowledge and true faith. Consequently, he wavers between blasphemy and faith, belief and disbelief, and admittance and denial. He is subject to vain whispers, is lost and doubtful, and is neither a faithful believer nor a rejecting disbeliever. Now, this statement is very, very important. One should keep it in his heart and act in its accordance. Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi, may Allah raise his rank, is mentioning that one's faith cannot be correct unless one surrenders to Allah without objection, and one does not attribute to him what does not befit him subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means one has to hold the conviction in the heart, the belief in the heart, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is attributed with the attributes of perfection, the attributes that befit him subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he denies any of Allah's attributes, known by necessity, like the 13 attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal, one becomes a blasphemer. So one should surrender to Allah Azza wa Jal, submit himself to Allah the Creator, by believing in the existence of Allah, by believing in the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He does not object and he does not attribute to Allah azza wa jal that which does not befit him. So one must submit to accept whatever Allah debarred the creation from knowing. Because he should realize and acknowledge that you are a creation of God. Your knowledge is very, very limited. And there are matters that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala debarred you from knowing. You won't be able to reach that knowledge no matter what you do. Like, for instance, the reality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Arabic we say, haqiqatullah. No one knows the reality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except Allah. We are creations. What we do, we believe in Allah. We believe in His existence. We believe in the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So a Muslim would have in his heart this belief. Allah exists. The existence of Allah is without a beginning, without an end. Allah is attributed with the attributes of perfection that befit Him, like hearing, sight, knowledge, power, will, non-neediness of the creations, non-resemblance to the creations, and the like. One would hold this conviction in his heart because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributed these attributes to Himself in the Quran. Also, the sound mind judges that the Creator must be attributed with these attributes. For instance, power. The mind judges that the Creator must be attributed with power. Otherwise, if the Creator doesn't have power, He wouldn't be the Creator. Will. If the Creator is not attributed with will, nothing from this universe would have come into existence, because it came into existence by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. And because Allah is the Creator of everything, Allah hears all the hearable things, Allah sees all the seeable things, and so on. As a Muslim, you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know about Allah Azza wa Jal through His attributes. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributed to Himself in the Quran, you believe in, and by this, that will be your knowledge about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But some people do not get satisfied with this amount of knowledge, and they want to search further and further. They want to indulge in digging more and more, claiming that they want to reach the reality of Allah Azza wa Jal, which is impossible. What do they end up doing? They end up imagining something and believing that this image is Allah wal-Iyazu Billah. And by this, they would have blasphemed, because they are worshipping in that case an image that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in them. You don't know everything about yourself. How would you be able to know about the Creator? Everything about the Creator, I mean the reality of the Creator, you won't be able to reach it. One of the poets said, حقيقة المرء ليس المرء يدركها فكيف يدرك كنها الخالق الأزلي. If you don't know everything about yourself, how would you be able to know about the reality of Allah Azza wa Jal? You won't be able to. So what we know about Allah Azza wa Jal is through His attributes. Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributed Himself with, we know Allah Azza wa Jal through these attributes. We do not try to imagine Allah Azza wa Jal, because Allah is not something that can be imagined in minds. For that reason, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do not attempt to imagine Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not attempt to imagine Allah, because if you were to attempt to imagine Allah Azza wa Jal, you will reach a stage where you have an image, and if you believe that that image is Allah, you'll be committing blasphemy and worshipping other than Allah Azza wa Jal. Imam Al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu said a very, very nice statement that is a cure for all of those who want to be steadfast on the right path.
He said, if one were to know about his creator, and he reaches a stage where he imagines something claiming that this is God, then he is mushabbih, meaning this is a person who likened Allah to his creations. If he reaches a stage which is the absolute denial of the existence of Allah Azza wa Jal, then that is atheism, and by this he will be an atheist. He denied the existence of Allah. However, if he reaches a stage where he believes in the existence of Allah and he admits that he is short from reaching the reality of Allah Azza wa Jal, then this is the true muwahhid. So no denial to the existence of Allah and no likening to the creations. So one wouldn't be likening Allah to the creations, and one wouldn't be denying the existence of Allah. He would be believing in the existence of Allah. He will be believing that Allah is attributed with the attributes of perfection that befit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he clears Allah from any resemblance to the creations. But if a person doesn't get satisfied with the amount of knowledge that he would be able to reach about Allah Azza wa Jal, then he will be going to his destruction. Imam Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu said, Al-ajizu an daraki al-idraki idraku wal-bahthu an zatihi kufrun wa ishraku. If you admit your shortage of reaching the reality of Allah Azza wa Jal, this is the true belief. This is the proper knowledge that you have. Then he said, وَالْبَحْثُ عَنْ ذَاتِهِ, meaning if you want to indulge in reaching the reality of Allah Azza wa Jal, this is kufrun wa ishraku. This is blasphemous. So Imam At-Tahawi is saying that the person who doesn't get satisfied with the knowledge that he is able to reach, and he wants to go further trying to seek the knowledge he is debarred from reaching, this person will be far from holding the absolute tawheed and having pure knowledge about Allah. Consequently, he believes in some of what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought and disbelieves in the rest. So he wavers between acknowledging and renouncing the truth. He believes in some and denies the rest, becoming confused and lost. As a result, he's neither like an outspoken blasphemer nor like a true believer. Such a person is definitely a blasphemer. So we accept what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made us able to reach of the knowledge about Allah Azza wa Jal, and we do not object to Allah Azza wa Jal for not being able to reach what we are debarred from reaching, and we acknowledge our shortage in reaching the reality of Allah Azza wa Jal, and we surrender to Allah Azza wa Jal and we submit to Him. I believe in Allah, I believe in His Messenger, I believe in Allah as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributed to Himself in the Quran, the attributes of Allah, the attributes of perfection, and we don't go further. Going further, digging deeper and deeper, trying to reach the knowledge that you are debarred from reaching, will make you in the end imagine something, and when you believe that this is Allah, then you turn out of Islam. That's why Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi is trying to draw your limits, to make you safe Surrender to Allah Azza wa Jal. Be within your boundaries. Do not cross your boundaries. What do you know about Allah Azza wa Jal? Is it through His attributes. Do not liken Allah to the creations and do not deny the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Believe in the attributes of Allah as Allah attributed to Himself without likening Allah to the creations. Then he mentioned something important. We spoke about this topic before, but now he's repeating this because of its importance. He said, the belief in the seeing of Allah with the eyes in the hereafter by the occupants of the abode of peace, and that is paradise, is not valid to the one who considers it delusionally or misinterprets it in his mind. The correct interpretation of this seeing and of every meaning ascribed to lordship is given by abandoning misinterpretation and by adhering to unreserved submission. This is what the religion of the Muslims asserts. Something very important. He is assuring something that in the past Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah debated with other groups regarding this topic, which is seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the people of the truth, the majority of this nation, the mainstream Muslims, are in the middle. They said, Allah ta'ala said in the Quran, وَجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاضِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make the faces of the people of paradise preserved and protected from any signs of depression and anxiety, so they will be happy and Allah will enable them to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So ila rabbiha nazira, that means they will be enabled to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when they are in paradise. Same as Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be seen in the hereafter. The believers in paradise will be enabled to see Allah azza wa jal. They will see Him by the eyes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates for them in the hereafter, without Allah being in a place or direction, without Allah having a shape or a volume, and without any distance between the people of paradise and the Creator. Because Allah is not a creation, is not a body. And that's why the way they see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not like the way they see a creation. The way we see each other, we look at a direction, we look at a place, because we are looking at bodies. This is the way you see a body. Direction, place, form, shape, and the like. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator. Allah is not a body. So seeing Allah azza wa jal is not like seeing a creation. That's why Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi is emphasizing what Imam Abu Hanifa said in his book Al-Fiqh al-Akbar before him. Because he is Hanafi, as we mentioned. He's saying that seeing Allah is a matter of truth, meaning the people of paradise will see Allah Azza wa Jal. Some will be enabled to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once a week. Some maybe see Allah once a year. So it depends on the level of piety. And that depends on the deeds in this life. So the people of paradise won't see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the same number of times, all of them. Some will see Allah more frequent than others. It depends on their deeds in this life. So this is confirmed in the Quran. وَجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاضِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّكُمْ لَنْ تَرَوْا رَبَّكُمْ حَتَّى تَمُوتُوا. Meaning you won't be able to see Allah until you die. Meaning after death, and that is when they are in paradise, they will be enabled to see Allah Azza wa Jal. In another hadith narrated by Imam Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that you will be able to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you won't have any doubt, any sign of confusion that what you're seeing is Allah or other than Allah. As when you see the moon when it is full, in a very clear night, you will know that this is the moon for sure. You won't have any confusion. So same case, meaning in the same case that you don't have any doubt. The Prophet is not likening Allah to the moon, a'udhu billah, no. The Prophet is trying to draw this analogy between not doubting when you see the moon when it is full, you know this is the moon for sure, and that's why the believers in the hereafter, when they are in paradise, Allah will enable them to see Allah. They will see Him and they will have no doubt that what they're seeing is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or other than Allah. They know this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's from the Quran, that's from the hadith. And the scholars of Islam, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah said, this is the belief of Muslims, as Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi stated. However, a group called Al-Mu'tazila in the past denied seeing Allah Azza wa Jal in the hereafter. What did they say? They said, and this is not true, this analysis they made is not right. Why? Simply because they are applying the rules that apply to the creations to Allah Azza wa Jal. They said, if Allah can be seen, that means Allah will be in a direction. If Allah is in a direction, that means Allah is in a place. If Allah is in a place, that means Allah is a body. And this is impossible, so Allah can never be seen. That's their analysis. It's wrong, because they based their analysis on the same way they would apply these rules to a creation. So if you were to ask me about seeing a human being, yeah, I would say to you, a human being is seen in a direction. A human being is seen in a place, because a human being has a body. So these rules apply to bodies and objects, but not to Allah Azza wa Jal, the creator of bodies and objects, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists without a place. And as we believe that Allah sees us, now Allah sees us without Allah being in a place, in the hereafter Allah will enable us to see Him without Him being in a place. It's very simple. So the Mu'tazila went to that extreme that they denied seeing Allah Azza wa Jal in the hereafter. And when they were confronted with the ayah that we mentioned, وَجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاضِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ, they said, إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ means waiting for the endowments of Allah Azza wa Jal. And the scholars of Ahl Sunnah refuted their claim by saying there is no waiting in paradise. You know, paradise, it's all a time of enjoyment, happiness, delightfulness. So you won't be waiting. There's no waiting in paradise. So this misinterpretation they made to the ayah is wrong. The other group is the Mushabbiha, Al-Mujassima, who say, we believe in seeing Allah Azza wa Jal, but they will see Allah in a place, in a direction, they will come and sit with Allah and talk to Him and the like, as if Allah is a human being, wal-ayyadhu billah. So this is the other extreme as well. So those commit blasphemy by likening Allah to the creations. And the other group, Al-Mu'tazila, had gone against the majority of Muslims by denying seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah are in the middle. So Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi radiallahu anhu is saying, the belief in the seeing of Allah with the eyes in the hereafter by the occupants of the abode of peace is not valid to the one who considers it delusionally, meaning the one who says that Allah will be in a place, direction, and they will have a distance between them and God. This is blasphemous. He said, or misinterprets it in his mind, like those who denied seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like the Mu'tazila, claiming that it's impossible that Allah can be seen. Now, the proof that it is possible for Allah to be seen, it's intellectually possible, it's not impossible, that Prophet Musa alayhi salam asked his Lord when he was at the Mount of Sina, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if he were to be enabled to see Allah azza wa jalla, if Allah would enable him to see Allah. Allah said, as mentioned in the Quran, قَالَ لَن تَرَانِي, you won't be able to see me. وَلَكِنْ انظُرْ إِلَى الْجَبَلِ, meaning in this life, you won't be able to see me in this life. As the Prophet confirmed this later. وَلَكِنْ انظُرْ إِلَى الْجَبَلِ فَإِنْ اسْتَقَرَّ مَكَانَهُ فَسَوْفَ تَرَانِي. Rather, look at the mountain. If it remains steady in its place without collapsing, you'll be able to see me. Now, the steadiness of the mountain, is it something impossible or it's something possible? It's possible for the mountain to remain in its place without collapsing. It's something possible. So Allah Azza wa Jal made the possibility of seeing Allah contingent to the steadiness of the mountain, which is something intellectually possible. And that means seeing Allah is something possible. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the barrier that would prevent that mountain from seeing Allah by creating in this mountain life and awareness and seeing, the mountain that is made of rocks and stones and sand, that mountain, Allah created in it awareness, life, and seeing. And that mountain saw Allah Azza wa Jal. When the mountain saw Allah, it collapsed. And Musa alayhi salam fainted, became unconscious upon seeing this great mountain. That mountain couldn't handle the magnificence of seeing Allah Azza wa Jal. That's why it collapsed. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Musa alayhi salam, لَن تَرَانِي, meaning in this life you won't be able to. But in the hereafter, when the believers are in paradise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates in them strength and creates for them eyes different from these eyes that will perish. Different eyes, strong eyes, and Allah will enable them to see Allah Azza wa Jal without Allah being in a place or direction, without Allah having a shape or a volume. This is the belief of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Then Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi said, the one who does not guard himself against negating Allah or his attributes and against likening Allah to his creation has strayed and has not declared Allah to be clear of imperfection. Our Lord, to whom glory and greatness belong, is attributed with the attributes of oneness and uniqueness. None of the creation has any of his attributes. So Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi is making it clear by this statement that one has to confirm the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He cannot negate the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At the same time, he cannot liken the attributes of Allah ta'ala to the attributes of the creation. So we confirm without likening Allah to the creations. And as we mentioned, he's trying to refute the claim of two sects at his time. One sect called Al-Mu'tazila, who denied the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal, and they used to say, Allah is knowledgeable without knowledge. Allah is powerful without power. And the like, it doesn't make sense. And they denied the attributes of Allah like power, sight, hearing, will. They deny these attributes. Now the one who denies and negates these attributes is a blasphemer. At the same time, the one who says, I believe that Allah is attributed with hearing, then he would say that Allah hears as we hear, is likening Allah to the creations. The one who says that Allah, I believe that Allah is attributed with speech, kalam, but Allah's kalam is like our kalam, letter, language, and sounds, is not a believer. Look at this statement. The one who does not guard himself against what? Against negating Allah or his attributes, and against likening Allah to his creations, has strayed and has not declared Allah to be clear of imperfection, meaning he's not a believer. So what's the belief of Muslims regarding the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? They confirm them, but they clear Allah from any resemblance to the creation. So what do Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah say about the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? They confirm them, and they clear Allah from any resemblance to the creations. Now, to make this clearer even, Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi said in the following statement, Allah is clear of having boundaries, extremes, sides, organs, and small parts. The six directions do not contain him, as they do contain all created things. Now, this statement needs a lot of explanation. He said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is clear of having boundaries. Anything that has boundaries is bounded, is a creation. Meaning you have boundaries, you have limits. Meaning you have a volume, you have a mass, you have a quantity. Anything that is like that is in need of the one who specified him with these boundaries and these limits and this mass and this quantity. And the one who is specified is in need of others. And the one who is in need of others is weak. And this disqualifies him from being God. Being in need of someone, meaning you are weak. To be weak, that disqualifies such a thing from being God. Because Allah Azza wa Jal is the creator. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the power over all his creations. So Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi is saying that Allah is clear of having a volume or boundaries, limits. Sides. Because Allah is the creator of sides. Look at the objects. If you have a cubic object, it has sides. If you have a rectangular prism, it has sides. If you have a cylindrical shape object, it has sides. So these objects, it doesn't matter how it looks like, it has sides. Allah Azza wa Jalla is clear of having sides. Also, Allah is clear of having large and small organs. The large organs are like the limbs, the hands and the legs. These are large organs, the limbs. And the small organs, such as the tongue and the teeth. These are small organs. This is what Imam Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi is stating, that Allah does not resemble the creations in any way. Allah doesn't have large organs or small organs. And this is what we have. We have limbs, we have tongue, and the like. Then he said, the six directions do not contain him, as they do contain all the created things. Any creation, any one of us, because we are bodies, we are confined to these six directions. We have above, we have below. Above you is a ceiling. Underneath you is the ground. Then you have something in front of you, something behind you. Something to your right, something to your left. The six directions encompass every one of us, contain us. So we are confined to the six directions because we are bodies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a body. Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu said, Al-Mujassimu kafir, as As-Suyuti narrated in his book Al-Ashbah wa Nazair. Al-Mujassimu kafir, meaning the one who says about Allah that he's a body, is a blasphemer. Imam Ahmad radiallahu anhu said, if someone says Allah is a body, even if he says, but not like other bodies, he's a kafir as well. Also, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal radiallahu anhu said a very famous statement, whatever you imagine in your mind, Allah does not resemble it. Because what you imagine is what? An image that is created, a creation. For that reason, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, La fikrata fi al-Rabb, do not attempt to imagine Allah. Because you'll end up having an image, thinking that it is Allah, and by this you blaspheme. And the four scholars of the four schools of Islamic jurisprudence, Shafi'i, Hanafi, Maliki, Hanbali, mentioned that whoever attributes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bodily attributes is a blasphemer. Al-Imam Al-Qarafi relayed that consensus. Relayed this consensus. That whoever attributes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a bodily attribute is a blasphemer. Imam Ali radiallahu anhu said, some of this nation will turn blasphemers at the end of the time, meaning before the day of judgment. They asked him, are they going to become blasphemers? They turn blasphemers because of something new they introduce, or by denying, he said, by denying their creator and attributing to their creator bodily attributes. So those who attribute to Allah a body and organs, as Imam Ali radiallahu anhu said, are blasphemers. He considered them as denying Allah Azza wa Jal, because such people do not have the correct knowledge about Allah Azza wa Jal. They have these misinterpretations, and their belief is against the belief of Muslims. Now let me clarify something that is very important. If you were to debate with those who attribute to Allah a direction or place, I'm talking about those who believe that Allah is a body living in the sky, and some of them say that Allah is above the throne, if you were to debate with them, they mention to you Hadith al-Jariyah, the hadith about the female slave that is narrated by Imam Muslim in his Sahih. And they consider this as their ultimate proof about what they claim. That's it. And they say to you, this is an authenticated hadith narrated by Imam Muslim. That's what they rely on. So how do you refute their claim? First of all, Imam al-Bayhaqi in his book As-Sunan al-Kubra categorized this hadith as muttarib. Muttarib, a type of weak hadith. Why? Because it is narrated in different narrations. Every narration contradicts the other narration, and there is no way to reconcile between all these different narrations. I'll explain it further. This hadith of the female slave was narrated in different ways. Each story is different from the other story, and they all go to the same person who narrated it. So one person called Muawiyah ibn al-Hakam narrated it, and all these narrations are different. So when you have a hadith narrated in different ways, and these narrations contradict each other, so you cannot reconcile between the meanings, this is a sign that this hadith is muttarib. So when this person once is saying, the Prophet said such and such. At another time he's saying, the Prophet said such and such about the same story, but he narrates something different. You know that this hadith is not authenticated. So Imam al-Bayhaqi categorized this hadith as muttarib. What does this hadith say? This is what is narrated in Sahih Muslim. Listen carefully so you won't misunderstand. A person had a female slave and she was grazing his sheep. She overlooked one of his sheep that went far away from the flock or the herd of sheep. When it went far away from the herd, what happened? The wolf came and ate it. A wolf came and ate it. When she came back and she mentioned to her master what happened, her master was angry. He couldn't control his temper and he slapped her on her face because she overlooked this sheep and it was eaten by the wolf. So he slapped her on her face. Then he regretted doing such a thing. He went to the Prophet and he said, O Messenger of Allah, I have a female slave. So and so happened, so I slapped her on her face. Should I free her? He wants to do what? To show a goodwill after what he did. Should I free her? Now in Sahih Muslim it says that the Prophet said to him, bring her to me. So he brought her to the Prophet. Listen carefully. The word Aina in Arabic, Aina, can mean where, when you're asking about something, you say, Aina wada'ta al-kitab, where did you put the book? So you're asking about the place of the book. Also, Aina in Arabic can be used in reference to status. You would say, Aina fulan min fulan. Let us say someone, he is imitating that he is Umar ibn al-Khattab. He is imitating that he is Umar ibn al-Khattab. He is imitating Umar. And he said, I'm Umar ibn al-Khattab. A person would say to him, Aina anta min Umar? Aina anta min Umar? Meaning, there's a big difference between your status and the status of Umar radiyallahu anhu. That would be the meaning of it. Aina anta min fulan? Meaning, there is a big difference between your rank and the rank of that person. They say also in Arabic, Aina thara min al-Thuraya? Al-Thuraya, a constellation of stars called al-Thuraya. Al-Thara, the soil. Aina thara min al-Thuraya? Meaning, big difference between the sand, the soil, and that constellation of stars. So they use that term, Aina, and what they are referring to, status. They are referring to status. What is mentioned in Sahih Muslim is as follows, that the Prophet said to her, Aina Allah, which Imam al-Nawawi, the one who explained Sahih Muslim, said, it's a query about the status, not the place. So when he said, Aina Allah, it can mean, how much do you glorify Allah Azza wa Jal? Meaning, what do you believe about the status of God? And she said, Fis-sama. Fis-sama, meaning Allah's status is very high. Then the Prophet said, free her, she is a believer. This hadith that is narrated by Imam Muslim with these terms is what those people rely on to claim that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a body and in the sky, and sometimes they say above the throne and the like. We say this same hadith was narrated in different narrations. Imam al-Nasa'i, in his book Amal al-Yawm al-Layla, mentioned that the Prophet asked her, Man Rabbuki? He didn't say Ayn Allah. He said, Man Rabbuki? Meaning, who is your Lord? She said, Allah. He said, who is your Prophet? She said, Muhammad. What's your religion? She said, Islam. Then he said, free her because she is Muslim. It's totally different. In another narration by Al-Bayhaqi, that when he asked her, Ayn Allah, she pointed to the sky. She pointed because she was mute, unable to talk. So in one hadith narrated by a Muslim, it says that she said, Fis-sama, which literally means in the sky, but cannot be taken in that way. In that hadith, it says that she was mute. Not only that, in Muwatta, Imam Malik, by consensus, is the most accurate narrator of hadith. By consensus, Imam Malik narrated in his book Al-Muwatta that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to her, do you testify that no one is God except Allah? She said, yes. Then he said, do you testify that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah? She said, yes. Then he said, free her because she is a believer. That's the narration of Imam Malik. So how many narrations we mentioned? What Bayhaqi mentioned, what An-Nasa'i mentioned, what Imam Malik mentioned, what Imam Muslim mentioned. So there are different narrations and they cannot be reconciled, the meaning of which cannot be reconciled. So for that reason, the scholars categorize this hadith as what? Weak hadith, muttarib they call it. Muttarib, meaning different narrations, and they cannot reconcile between the meanings of these narrations. Is that clear up to here? So we mentioned different narrations that shows that this hadith is muttarib, and for that reason the scholars judge this hadith and categorize this hadith as muttarib, so they cannot rely on it. Okay, second, we mentioned what Imam Muslim mentioned in al-Sahih was explained by Imam al-Nawawi. Imam al-Nawawi wrote an explanation for the whole Sahih of Muslim. When narrating this hadith, Imam al-Nawawi commented that this question cannot be a query about the place, because Allah is clear of being in a place. Rather, it's a query about the status of Allah. As they say, how much do you glorify Allah? And when she said, fi sama, meaning Allah's status is the highest. As when we say Allahu Akbar, Allah is the greatest. Not talking about size, we mean in status. Allah's status is the greatest. That's our meaning when we say Allahu Akbar. When we say Allahu Al-Ali, Sadaq Allahu Al-Ali, Al-Ali meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the highest in status, not in place and direction. Clear up to here? Okay. So Imam al-Nawawi mentioned that this hadith, in case it is authenticated, the meaning of it will be, how much do you glorify Allah, when she said, fi sama, meaning Allah's status is the highest. There is something very important. When the Prophet used to call people to Islam, what did he used to tell them to do or to say? Yeah, let me hear it from you. What did he used to tell them to say? Shahada. Hatta yashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anni rasulullah. He used to pass by them and tell them, say, no one is God except Allah, and believe that I'm the messenger of Allah. So the testification of faith is the gate to Islam. So if one were to become Muslim, he must say the shahada in order to become Muslim. This hadith is mutawatir. Mutawatir meaning a very, very strong hadith. The highest level of hadith is mutawatir. And this hadith shows that a person would be judged Muslim when he does what? When he says and utters the two testifications of faith. This hadith is mutawatir, the highest level of sahih hadith. The one narrated by Muslim, if they want to take it literally, it would mean that the Prophet judged her as Muslim for saying God is in the sky. And this hadith contradicts the mutawatir hadith, حَتَّى يَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهُ, which is narrated by 15 companions. It's the highest level of authenticity. That's one thing. Plus, it contradicts the fundamental rules of the belief. Because amongst the fundamental rules of the belief is that one is judged as Muslim when he utters the two testifications of faith. Not when he says God is in the sky. Because as you know, there are non-Muslim sects, groups, non-Muslims, they say God is in the sky. So it's something common between them. They say God is in the sky. So it's impossible to believe that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that's impossible, deemed her as Muslim or judged her as Muslim simply because she said God is in the sky. Because an unbeliever say God is in the sky. So those people cannot take this hadith literally and say that it means this lady was believing that God is in the sky and the Prophet deemed her as Muslim because of that belief. This is not tried. They might say to you, yeah, but this is narrated by Imam Muslim. Imam Muslim authored this book called Sahih Muslim because he judged all these hadith that he narrated as what? Sahih. So would it be not sahih, yeah, not authenticated, although Imam Muslim narrated it? You say yes. Because there are some hadith in Sahih Muslim other narrators of hadith didn't judge them as sahih, didn't agree with Imam Muslim that this hadith is sahih. You know, like for a hadith to be categorized as sahih, the scholars would take many things into consideration. They studied the chain of narrators, and they studied the case of each person. Is he a trustworthy person? Is he accurate when he relates, like narrates? Or he forgets, he misses out something? So they checked every single person, and they look at many aspects, and that's why they end up saying, to me, I found this hadith to be sahih. But you might find another scholar of hadith who would not classify it as sahih. I'll give you three examples in Sahih Muslim. Three. The first, in Sahih Muslim, it is mentioned that a person came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him about his father. And it says that the Prophet replied by saying, your father and my father are in hellfire. This is narrated by Muslim in his Sahih. But Al-Hafiz As-Suyuti, that's another Hafiz of hadith, said this hadith is da'if, weak. It's not authenticated. The second hadith, it says that for every Muslim who goes to paradise, one from the people of the book will go to hellfire. So that will be like a ransom for his safety. For him to be in paradise, one from the people of the book will be thrown into hellfire. Imam al-Bukhari said this hadith is rejected. Imam al-Bukhari. And who is more knowledgeable, al-Bukhari or Muslim? Bukhari. Bukhari is the Shaykh of Muslim. He's Shaykh. And the third hadith is when Muslim narrated a hadith through Anas ibn Malik that he said, I prayed behind the Prophet, I prayed behind Abu Bakr and behind Umar, and they never used to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim at the beginning of the recitation. Imam al-Shafi'i said this is a weak hadith. So I gave you three examples. Now you know what does that mean when you use he, yeah, narrated by Muslim, but some scholars said it is weak. Yeah, this is not Quran, you know what I mean? It's a book of hadith that Imam Muslim compiled, and he put all his effort to put the authentic hadith in it. But some hadith that he included and he categorized as sahih, other scholars didn't agree with him. Is that clear? That's why Imam al-Bukhari, simply you say to this person, when he says to you, this hadith is authenticated, say to him, why Imam al-Bukhari didn't narrate it in his sahih? Why he didn't mention it in his sahih? Why it is only in Sahih Muslim? Because Imam al-Bukhari didn't say a sahih hadith. And it's enough to say what I mentioned to you, that according to what you say, that the Prophet judged her as Muslim just because she said God is in the sky. You know, the non-believers say God is in the sky. And they cannot take all these ahadith literally. They cannot say, yeah, we take him literally, because that will lead them to believing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in different places. Because Allah said, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. If taken literally, this ayah would mean that Allah is physically with every one of us. There is another ayah that says, وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ. If taken literally, it would mean that Allah is stuck with our jugular vein. Allah Ta'ala said as well in the Quran, الرحمن على العرش استوى. If taken literally, it would mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the throne. Allah ta'ala said, أَأَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ. If taken literally, it would mean that Allah is in the sky. Allah mentioned about Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam that when he went to Palestine, he said, إِنِّي ذَاهِبٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّي سَيَهْدِينَ. So if taken literally, it would mean that Allah is in Palestine. So if they want to take all these verses literally, it would mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the throne, in the sky, everywhere, with every one of us, stuck to our necks, in Palestine. And this is impossible. So rather, the scholars of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah assigned proper interpretation for these ayahs. They said, for instance, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ means Allah knows about you wherever you go. So they interpreted this by knowledge. So Allah knows about you wherever you go. This is how you interpret these ahadith. And the last thing I would like to mention as well, the hadith that when a person donates, makes a donation, in the hadith it says, الصدقة تقع في كف الرحمن. So if taken literally, it would mean that whenever a person gives a donation, it falls in the hand of God. But what person would believe that Allah has a physical organ, and that whenever a person makes a donation, that donation falls in God's hand? And what does that mean? That would mean that the hand of this person making the donation is above the hand of God, as they claim. What is the commandment in this interpretation? They are attributing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributes of imperfection. And Allah is clear of. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us steadfast on the correct belief and make our end as righteous Muslims. Ameen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. We say La ilaha illallah 3 times.